Lulu barely got nerfed on the first patch.
Hello and welcome everybody to the Odyssey Reckoning Update Show. It's crazy to think that it's already time for another Odyssey, but here we are. I'm Isaiah, your host for today.
Okay.
We've got an awesome show lined up for you guys. We've got tons of balance, some new skins. Of course, we're going to break down the new Odyssey for you guys. And with the new Odyssey comes a new
love
Tier
Isaiah.
5. We've got Tier 5 Hell, the grand reveal for that, towards the bottom of the show. Like I said, we've got a show that's ready for you guys. We got so much to go over. We're going to kick things off with balance. And to break things down with me, I've got
we're starting with
my
balance.
Homies from
nice.
The design team. I've got Clumsy and Ponpon here to start breaking things down with me. How you guys doing?
Good. Things are going well.
Doing all right.
I got your nose.
Nice. Well,
exciting stuff.
I don't know about you guys, but mid-season wrapped up, and we've kind of seen a little bit of how the meta has kind of fallen into place after the latest update, God of the Moon. So let's go ahead and get right into bonus balance because we've got actually a sizable amount to go over.
Oh,
so we'll kick it off with items.
A sizable amount of bonus balance. Okay.
And we'll start off with Ring of Hecate. And the first item up for this, Ring of Hecate, we're going to be decreasing the attack speed on the item. And we're also going to be decreasing the magical lifesteal.
Nice.
Yeah, so I think you're going to see a couple of things that are going to be familiar to the community. ADC mages are going to be taking a little bit more of a hit. We've seen, you know, Hecate still rising in dominance even with the last pair of nerfs. So we're going to do a couple of small tweaks here to the base stats, but you're going to be seeing a little bit more in tune with the ADC mages coming along next.
Cool.
For sure.
Good. Right,
let's
30
right
to 25, 20 to 15.
It's kind of in line with this Ring of Hecate.
Good.
You've got Typhon's Fang up next, and we're going to be decreasing the healing obtained from magical lifesteal from 40% down to 30%.
That's a bummer for the Hades
Ring
guide.
Ring of Hecate and Typhon's Fang, those are items that are built together and synergize really well. Mm-hmm. They give a lot of the magical ADCs really high boxing capability, and so toning both them down at once is going to be a big hit to like the core build that we've been seeing, the high frustration build that we've been seeing.
Somewhere Gooby's like, what did I do?
Got one more item up for bonus balance, and this is kind of targeted
Freya!
Towards some of our basic attack junglers here. Hasten Katana going to be seeing a nerf. We're
going to
be decreasing
really?
The attack speed on the item. We're also going to
really?
Be decreasing the movement speed.
Really?
Yeah, we've definitely Hasten. Seen a lot of rise from the ADC mage as well as the attack damage assassins.
I mean,
we did some mess around with the jungle with the Golden Blade and Assassin's Blessing before, and we see in prominence that the attack damage assassins have definitely risen up. And again, with the ADC mages, we're going to see a couple of attack damage assassins as well, specifically gods, get hits as well as this item for Hasten Katana.
I wouldn't have said that Hasten
for
Katana.
Sure. All right, that wraps it up for items. Let's
was
move right
the broken
to
one.
And everybody watching,
honestly,
this is not an alphabetical order,
okay.
But there's definitely a method to the madness, and we'll go ahead and kick it off with Tsukiyomi. Before I break down all the changes, Pon, how did Tsukiyomi kind of land when he released
so are they gonna nerf him
yeah,
or are they
so
just gonna bug
a,
fix
we had
him
we had a lot of interesting theories internally about where he'd fall. We knew that he was an assassin without mobility. Mm-hmm. But we knew that he also had high damage to kind of make up for that fact and some control tools in his kit.
This will be interesting.
And so when we first got stats, he was actually doing pretty well, and then people very quickly learned all the intricacies and really dominated with him. He had really good stats across the board, and so now we're here with some pretty consistent nerfs across the board, focused mostly on affecting his base damage output. And seeing where he falls after these kind of adjustments.
I'm surprised that they're gonna make significant nerfs. They almost never do that.
A little bit, and we're gonna be seeing that with Dark Moon Shuriken.
Let's see what they do.
The scaling, Kusari Gama decreasing the damage on all three hits.
90% to 80% scaling. That's fine.
Silver Moon Caltrops. We're gonna be
here. We go
decreasing the damage on that.
35, 135. That's still fine. 70 to 280.
So
disarm. That's fine. Okay.
Be dealing a little bit less damage.
Okay.
Yep. When he's played Pure Assassin, he does a lot of damage, but also when he was building Bruiser, he was doing quite a bit of damage. This base damage nerf will affect not only his early clear and early jungle capabilities, but also how effective his early ganks are, and then, of course, just how he scales into the late game. His scaling is still quite high on a lot of things, but we're going to watch that closely, see how these adjustments
he got damage
first,
nerfs.
Hitting some of the control that he also got out of utility.
But
if we need further nerfs, maybe some
more
scaling
targeted nerfs,
we can also do that.
Where a nerf comes for God that just come out. That's not a huge nerf.
Let's move on and talk about some magical ADCs.
That's not a huge nerf.
Coming up first with the nerf here. Turn of Fate.
So,
we're going to be decreasing.
That's pretty in line with how they buff
the
nerf god that have just been released.
To 50%, and I'll let Clumsy take it away here.
Yeah,
this is a revert to a buff that we gave him previously. Alderaan's been
very strong,
where he's always been seen to be a very strong god, especially with that ultimate, and I think that's going to be a big point of discussion. But with the ADC mage items that have you know, increase in power. We found some of the buffs that we gave him recently to be kind of unnecessary, and we want to bring him down without having to touch the ultimate, which is such a fine tuning dial that we want to be very careful of. We think with the item changes, with this revert, he should be in a much better spot. We don't think we'll see him, you know, as highly.
To be fair, Alderaan is an ult bot.
And, you know, it'll probably be okay.
Yeah, no. You can't touch his ulti. If you nerf his ulti, Alderaan sucks.
The next magical ADC we've got.
It's like 90% of the reason you pick Alderaan.
We're going to be making a change to Pulse here, decreasing the slow from 25% at all ranks, and that's going to be scaling up from 15% up to 25%. What's going on with Freya?
Interesting. So Freya, so Freya's slow kind of nerf.
She's
love
like
it.
Our character that we actually did like a full-on revert from at one point. So we want to be very careful on the actual balance number tuning stuff that we do for her. In this case, we figured the items are the things that are mostly enabling her. And so we've toned them down. But it does seem that her early control, especially when Pulse lands and slows everyone, that allows her to follow up really heavily with a lot more damage. Reducing the slow, especially in the early ranks where you might prioritize other your single target damage over this in some cases.
If that's all they're doing, then Freya is still insane. She's still the best ADC in the game, if that's all they're touching.
For sure.
Even with the other changes. She's still the best ADC in the game.
Basic attack assassins.
He'll still ban every game.
Bakasura is going to be up first, and we're making a change to Insatiable Hunger.
He's getting a lot of changes lately.
And movement speed per step.
Interesting.
And then also decreasing the slow duration on Regurgitate.
Yeah, so whatever we do jungle changes, Bakasura and the one coming up are always ones, or one of the gods, you know, just fluctuate really highly depending on what we do for them.
I haven't seen Baka doing very well lately, actually.
Just clear the jungle extremely
I'm gonna be
well
honest with you.
We're doing a small
my anecdotal evidence has been that Bakas have not been doing great.
Because we know there's a lot of frustration factor when it comes to that ultimate. And
to be fair,
to
he is a great
CC
farmer,
again,
but
there.
I haven't
so we're
seen him
or decrease it. We want to.
I haven't seen him in ranked
well.
A lot,
and we think this couple of Hasten Katana nerfs should be pretty good to bring him in line.
He hasn't been around that master's All level
right.
recently.
The next one up is specifically for you, Pawn. We're going to be making a nerf to Arachne here. Going to be making a change to Venomous Bite, decreasing the damage per tick on that ability. So talk to me about Arachne.
10 to 50 to 10 to 42 decrease from 110 to 450 to 110 to 402.
She's again a character that wildly fluctuates. She was on the uptick from that. So we were looking at a way to address her overall clear speed and her
Arachne
game potential.
Arachne nerf makes more sense to me than the Baka nerf
right
now.
Which is something that she could pop onto a target and they really had no answer to. So we're lowering the damage on that.
But I really feel like
other,
Nemesis and Quang are the biggest
spot.
Problems in the jungle right now.
All right, we've got a few more gods left for this bonus balance round. And these next ones are going to be focused a little bit more on what we've kind of been seeing in the SPL. What's going on with early plays. So first up, we've got Persephone. We're going to be making a nerf to Harvest.
Persephone's banned every game. That's fine.
Magical power scaling.
That's
damage,
good.
And also decreasing the slow on the ability.
Cool.
Bud, you want to go ahead and take this one?
Yeah, sure. Harvest is one of those abilities that has a lot of different skill potential at different skill levels. At the very top end, Sprout, the one that explodes, is actually the most commonly used because players know how to juke around the kind of targeted plant. So you see a lot of skillful usage of this ability, but it is a very consistent, very easy to confirm, hard to play around type of ability where she has her whole field
that
out.
It is.
And so Harvest being reduced on both the damage output scaling and the slow will make her less safe, let her do less damage, especially in like the late game, and should take a little bit of the edge off, allowing other mages to really kind of come into the slot and compete with her for picks and bans.
That's great. I like that. Always down for Persephone.
Right, next up, we've got Amaterasu, another highly contested pick so far in this in
better
this
be
phase.
A nerf, too.
Going to be making a change to Heavenly Reflection, decreasing the damage on the ability from 70 to 210. That's going down to 70 to 190.
How long have I been saying that AMA and, is OP?
That's going to be specifically a change catered towards the late game. Amaterasu's early game, we've seen, you know, fluctuate a little bit. We think she's in a really good spot with that mirror damage so that...
I don't think this is going to change her, though.
...she can now compete in the early game, where before it might have been a little bit harder. And to the late game, where that damage does go pretty high, the multiplier...
Honestly,
on the,
I don't think... AMA's 2 isn't what makes her OP. It's her passive and her 1.
So I think just a
small passive and her 1 are insane.
Is not too overwhelming.
Insane.
All right, next up, we've got Cthulhu.
She'll
here.
Still be just as good.
Descend into Madness, the ultimate ability. We're making a change here. We're going to be decreasing the duration that he
dang right
is
you
in
are.
His form.
You're dang
from
right.
12 to 16 seconds.
Okay.
And that's going down to
2 seconds.
Seconds
is decent. That's a good.
Seconds.
That's decent.
So, minus 2 seconds at all.
That's a little bit of time.
Yeah, if you've ever been in the dual lane or the solo lane, they it's not bad. That's not bad. Five and gets to just kind of wail on you for a while. The extra 2 seconds off means that he's going to be losing out on like a claw or two, yep. maybe an extra of the knockup ability. And so this is just going to take some of that edge off ultimate, make it so enemies have a bit more counterplay around it, lower time dealing with the effects of this kind of descendant right. Okay.
I can deal with that.
All right. And we've got one more guardian left up for bonus balance. Our last god here that we're changing next week is Umoja.
Yeah.
Really making a change to bouncing bubbles, decreasing the nerf damage, and also decreasing the slow duration for when it hits an enemy.
Yeah, for sure.
So Umoja is also an interesting good one. Change. Obviously, her not having mana really affects the way she starts playing the game. And we talked to a lot of different pro players and casual players. She's actually not doing that well in the casual scene, like at all. No. I believe she's sub 50 by a pretty good margin. But in the SPL, she's pretty much 100% pick ban, and that's where we have to be very careful. We expect those nerfs to be,
broken.
But I think that they've been kind of vocal recently, the past few months to make sure that she is still pretty strong. The decreased damage we think is going to hit the SPL pretty heavily, the competitive players, where she's not going to be able to clear waves with the hunter just like, at level one and two, where she has access to so many abilities. So these are going to be some pretty big damage nerfs, as well as slow to help, those competitive players set up for the next abilities and their partners.
All
so
good bonus balance changes.
The casual players won't suffer too much.
So those goes live. Those goes live in six days.
We'll see where she lands. 6 days. Those go live. These nerfs go live. So that wraps it up for bonus balance. That's going live next week. But we also got a few skins.
Love that.
That we want to show off. That are going to be
love all those changes
next Tuesday. We'll start it off with the new moon event.
No problems
that's
with any of that
going on right now. We've got a ton of bundles, ton of awesome skins, and the final bundle in the new moon event is going to be going live next week. And the first skin that we kind of want to highlight from bundle 4 of the event is Shadow Weaver Neith. And
oh my god, it's a Neith skin.
We'll
I almost memed and said, "Ooh, give me a Neith skin."
All the skins you in like, this theme are just so cool.
They can't
everyone
help
has,
it.
Like, they're very
you know,
similar,
there's
got to
be a Neith skin in the patch.
It's so cool.
Also, oh, this creature in the back of that card art, that was terrifying.
You see this skin?
Yeah,
you
like
see this skin? This is why Neith keeps getting skins. Because we look at the skin and we all go, ooh, that looks really good. I'm going to buy it. That's why we get so many Neith skins. We're the problem. You see, you're the problem. I'm the problem. We're the problem.
Such a pattern for you.
That's awesome. Definitely going to be one that I'm looking forward to.
We make fun of every patch having a Neith skin, but we keep buying the Neith skins.
Coming up in Bundle 4 of New Moon. And the other skin that's coming up in Bundle 4 of the New Moon event is Unbroken Osiris. And this one is like super crucial in that torture thing.
Does
that helmet?
He already has.
What do you think about this one?
Who has
I
a
love
skin
just,
that
like,
looks
at the
just
pieces,
like
kind
this?
Of, whether it's the card art or in game, you can see something new each time. It's really ornate. And
Zeus.
I think it's really intricate and interesting.
Is it is it Guan? Is
definitely.
It Zeus?
And,
I think it might be Zeus.
Into the
is that
a
theme, right?
Take a look at the model. You guys will definitely see some of the more details.
Oh, okay,
the
it doesn't look at all like it in game. Just the card art.
Don't want to go against that
that's
guy
cool.
in lane. He.
That's cool.
I wonder what it's going to look like.
Oh, a couple of guys do? Oh, Zeus and Guan, both do. Oh, yeah, and Oleron. Yep.
Come, embrace the pain.
Oh, daddy.
He is definitely ready to box in solo lane. Like I said, I do not want to go up against him. But that wraps it up for the New Moon event. That's the final bundle that's going to be available in the event. And I just want to take a moment to remind you guys that if you guys get all four bundles in the New Moon event, you'll be able to unlock that unlimited Angelic Archon Umoja that we revealed on the last update
that's
show.
That's fine. So those are in the bonus balance.
Skin. The effects on it are really cool. If you guys missed out, I know there was a lot of feedback
this
on
this skin is
model.
Already in game, I think.
It definitely looks super awesome.
In fact, I'm positive it is. If you pre-ordered the whole bundle, the skin is already in game. Yeah.
So next up, we've got the Dreamweaver chest that is coming out for you guys. And the skin in this chest is going to be Dreamweaver Ganesh. And this one is, I didn't know how to feel about it at first. It's kind of like, I don't know if he's is he supposed to scare me or is he supposed to be peaceful? But he's definitely
from
Dreamweaver
Ganesh.
What do you guys think about this one?
Okay.
Yeah, this is it's a very interesting take on like forest kind of guardian spirit type creature. Like it's really hard to place him, but man, I love like the different takes on him with Ganesh.
Definitely.
Oh, dagger's
the pink and teal look really cool, and I love the weapons that he's got.
Yeah, the color scheme is pretty awesome.
Yeah. Let's go ahead and take a listen to the voice pack for Dream
I
Weaver
don't
Ganesh.
Know what to think
through
about
peace,
that.
We will bring balance. Through balance, we achieve victory.
So he doesn't
so
seem super creepy there. I think he's friendly.
I don't know.
All right,
I don't know.
The last skin that we've got.
I think I'm just medium on it.
You guys,
I think I'm just medium.
Interstellar Oleron, and I got to give a shout out to my man Kalani, who works on the
is
team.
This is an Oleron
skin? The concept on this looks absolutely
amazing. Was this a Kalani concept?
Dang, that's cool.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, this is a Kalani concept. And
that's a cool card art.
Shout out. Futuristic astronaut looks so dope.
And it looks pretty awesome.
Hat on the helmet.
Yep. The helmet and tail kind of better.
Yeah, I'm down, dude.
This one turned out super
sick.
I love
down.
The way that the helmet. It's not a traditional astronaut helmet. It's kind of super futuristic and pushes that
sci-fi
narrative. And this one's got a little bit of a backstory to it, and you guys might be able to figure out what's going on once we take a listen to the voice back.
I bet the abilities look sick on that skin.
Allow me to enlighten you.
So he's definitely got some ulterior motives there going on. That's kind of a little Easter egg for you guys. Once you hop into PCS, listen to some of those voice back lines and see if you guys could come up with a story there. This one turned out really awesome.
Yeah, now
that wraps it up for the bonus update that's coming up for you guys next week, next Tuesday. Be on the lookout for Smite Game on release information for that. But we've also got some community news that we want to go
community
over with you
news.
Guys. If you guys haven't heard, you've been living under a rock, we've got
the Avatar, it's the Baron that gets taken over from the Baron tier 5. There it is. Yep.
Get through that prestige track. So this weekend, you'll be able to get 2x battle points on every game played. Once you play the games this weekend, Pond Clumsy, how far are you guys in your battle pass?
I'm actually pretty sure I'm completed. I got it all.
Me too.
Oh yeah, I mean,
playing those games.
One of the pressure, I'm absolutely pressing the button to get everything because I want it all right now. That's no playing around with that.
Speaking of wanting it all right now, Dolson, I've been watching SPL and Dolson just makes me want a Maxnomic Smite chair so bad. So we definitely want to get you guys in the know on that one. We've got partnered with Maxnomic on an official Smite chair.
I didn't know. I was like, do I don't. I don't. Sorry.
Of the chair that you
had to look.
Down.
I was like, wait, have I been on one the whole time? I'm not.
It's super meta, so if you guys want to pick up that chair, you'll also be emailed the code for award in game. That way you can flex that you're, you know, sitting on the throne of the gods and your
the real chair was behind us all along.
Next up, we've got
confirmed awards.
I know, right? Next up, we've got an event that we want to let you guys know that's happening tomorrow right here on Twitch, on Smite Game. Type Cupcake from the community team is actually putting on a charity stream to benefit One Up on Cancer called Sprinkle of Hope. It's going to be a lot of fun. You guys can see we've got 2 time slots that are going on from 10 to 2 and then again from 4 to 8. We're going to be hanging out, playing some games, running some Smite the Devs, hopefully not giving away some titles, but it's all in the name of charity and it's benefiting One Up on Cancer. So definitely give a shout out to Titan Cupcake on that one. She's been leading this one and we're super excited for this charity event. Potter Clones, are you guys playing it tomorrow in the charity event or are you guys just going to be watching?
I'm just going to be watching. I have a lot of stuff I got to take care of tomorrow, unfortunately. But maybe sometime I can deny some titles from some people.
Speaking of watching on Twitch, we've got the SPL that's coming up this weekend. Like I said, phase 2 of the season has rolled off in
phase
full steam.
Two.
Tons of awesome matches, a lot of upsets. Everybody's getting some wins. So if you guys want to tune in,
okay, I was about to say,
Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
I was looking for Space Station.
PC.
I was like, where's Space Station playing?
This weekend.
That's all that really matters.
Match, Ghost versus Radiant.
Space Station versus
the
United.
Matchup.
Easy peasy, dude. Easy. Easy game, right. Easy life.
So I think that wraps it up for community news. You guys ready to kind of head out and start talking about the major update 7.9 that's coming out in September?
Major update, please.
Let's kick it off with some quality of life stuff. We've got a couple notes here. The mastery icon for 110 Gods Master. We're finally getting that into the game. We've seen a lot of people asking about it on social media. So you guys will be able to equip that avatar when this update goes live.
I was wondering where that was coming in.
There's an issue to where not all players were able to equip their past mastery avatars. So if you mastered like 100 gods, like if you level it up, you wouldn't be able to equip that avatar. So you'll be able to flex your masteries no matter how many that you have coming up in the next update. And then we've got one more, and I'll kind of throw it to Pawn after I explain it.
Okay.
We're going to be allowing for in-combat pauses in rank if we've got if the team has a player that's been disconnected.
Good.
Pawn, talk to me a little bit about this change here.
Good, so we have pausing, and generally
it cares about whether you're in combat or not, so people can abuse it for combat situations. But if a player is disconnected, that's generally a case where, no, we should really try and pause right now. Teams have to sacrifice quite a bit
to
get out of
change.
Combat. Just let them
pause,
let the person reconnect.
Is so
there's a nice quality of life improvement for players playing ranked.
That's great.
Outside of disconnects, it'll still function exactly as it has.
I love that.
Ooh, for sure.
That's actually a great
change. Into balance here, and we're gonna kick it off with Conquest. The Centaur ability rework in the jungle. This is the speed buff.
Uh-huh.
We're gonna be doing a rework to his ability. We renamed the ability to Charge Thrust, and the buff holder is now going to be doing a charge as its fourth attack.
Okay.
And we're gonna be decreasing the range and decreasing the ability wind up on it.
Good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we got some feedback around that when you're trying to pull the camp out to,
it
the,
wouldn't
to the
pull.
Edge of the area, you can stop and do this attack, so we put it further in the chain.
Yes.
The range is a little bit shorter, but it's a little bit faster. Often it was very easy to juke for junglers.
I guess
so
I wasn't the only person that was experiencing this. We were trying
just
to pull the camp,
the frustration around
and then you embarrass
it, as well as
yourself because he stops moving towards you. And then you whiff your auto attack, and then your mid laner misses the XP,
right,
and it's
like... And right at the top, we've got a couple of interesting items that are getting some pretty significant changes, like almost rework level changes to a couple items. Let's start off with Serrated Edge.
That's great.
We're going to be doing a shift
That change.
Increasing the cost, decreasing the physical power, but adjusting the passive.
For
every non-ultimate ability on cooldown, you gain a stack of cruelty.
Each
stack provides 10 basic attack power and 3% lifesteal. Who wants to talk to me about Serrated Edge?
I can take a stab at this one.
Yeah, go for
it. So, Serrated Edge is kind of the assassin, 20%
minus 5 power.
It has a very unique passive, carrying about
10
abas- but required all
attack
3 to
power
be on cooldown,
and
3%
which made it very
physical
limited on what
gods
could
use. Some of them are like can't really utilize it that effectively. Some have a very hard time or have very low cooldowns, so it's very hard to keep uptime on this. And so it made only certain gods really able to use this. So we're making it a bit more usable overall. Now it'll just care if you have a cooldown ability on cooldown, you get a stack, so you can get a maximum of 3 stacks. Which means other assassins can now use this.
That's a
good
change.
But because now it's just universally stronger, you're going to have more uptime on this type of buff. We had to do some adjustments to its item stat cost, its power, as well as the amount of stats provided.
That definitely
so
is a more universally
fully
usable
and fully functional. But you also have that extra flexibility now where you can use it. So this should put it into a more usable spot, make it not so just basically only Arachne was the character that was using this.
I'm down.
Yeah, definitely
I like
interested
that.
To see what other kind of junglers pick this up.
Much better for its versatility.
Next up, for another item that's getting a pretty significant shift, you've got Hide of the Nemean Lion, and we're making a change to the passive. The new passive is going to be every 15 seconds, you gain a block stack for every 100 total protections from items that you have, preventing the next basic attack from damaging you, and the stack lasts, it can only stack up to 3 times.
We think this is, you know, the reflex change going to block stacks has been really popular amongst a lot of the users.
For every 100 total protections
from
items.
But the problem with the Nemean Lion in its previous iteration, or its current one,
you
is
gain
that
one
a lot
block
more people
stack.
Than we intended were picking it up. You know, we were seeing it in a variety of cases, assassins were picking it up while diving on the hunters,
preventing
or mages
the next
were picking it up
basic
to
attack
kind of deny
from damaging
from
you.
To them. We wanted this to be somewhat more useful for the tankier characters, the warriors.
A nerf for
up,
squishies buying this
so
item,
kind of
but a buff
you get,
for tanks buying this item.
So that means if you just have this, actually you're going to be needing another item to drive you over that 100 total protections mark from items to gain your first block stack.
Okay.
And we think this, going up to 3 stacks now, will really help push it in the right direction.
Interesting.
Yep, the tankier you are, the better it is.
Yep.
Interesting.
So build those protections to get those block stacks.
Okay.
Speaking of blocking some basic attacks, let's talk about some bows that are getting some buffs here. We'll kick it off with Charged Bow.
Bow
we're gonna be,
buffs? Are we buffing
it now
bow?
Now has bonus damage. That's 30% of your physical scaling here. What's going on with the bows?
Yep. So in the OD bow has a scaling component to it, but the tier 2 version of it does not, which meant the tier 2 item felt very underwhelming. If you were building into it, it was really just a not useful item until you actually got it all the way upgraded to Odysseus's bow.
True.
So we're giving it some scaling, so building into that kind of build path is a bit more easy. You can back and buy this and feel pretty
so
good
just
about
the tier
it
two.
Rather than upgrading straight directly to Odysseus's bow.
All right, next up we've got Ichabal, and that's an item I feel
so
like
just the tier two to
time.
Make it easier to build a Nova.
Increasing the buff and debuff duration from 3 to 5 seconds, and then we also making a fix adjusting some text here to this and Ring of Hecate to better match the wording for the same effects that they provide.
Yeah, so the strength of Ring of Hecate definitely brought the comparative question to the Hunter item that's very similar, which is Ichabod. We know a lot of people wanted to see some crazy buffs to Ichabod instead of just nerfing Ring of Hecate. We didn't think adding Lifesteal to Ichabod was probably the right route, so we decided to go for some small nerfs for
Lifesteal Ichabod.
And then we noticed that Ichabod had a 3-second buff.
That would be something. That would be crazy.
To bring that in line to at least give you the same kind of boxing potential.
That would have been nuts. Okay.
All right, let's move on to some.
So it lasts a lot longer. That's nice.
Up first, we're going to be decreasing the cost on the item, adding 7 HP5, and then for the evolved version, we're going to be increasing the HP5 and the NP5 on the item.
Yeah, at this point, we have a lot of data on like usage rate and how good these magical pen items
Karen's
are.
Karen's coin does not
Karen's
give
coin, which
very
was
often.
Really picked up at the start, has fallen out of favor. People really aren't utilizing it anymore. Overall, it was just underwhelming. So we're reducing its cost to make it easier to build into and giving it a little bit of extra flavor. Okay. It now has a little bit of HP5 to start out to give you some extra sustain. And the evolved form actually gets more intense.
2600 to 2500. Increased HP5, MP5.
This was one of my favorite items when the season launched.
Minus 100
G. Picking it back up again.
One gold.
All right, okay.
There we go. I mean, we got Doom Orb up next.
That might put it a little bit more in the realm of getting picked up more.
Yeah, Doom Orb as well is one of those items that we did a lot of changes to. Ooh. And while it's still pretty strong, we think the cost is pretty prohibitive. So we're going to be decreasing the cost slightly and go from there. We think it's going to be pretty good.
Oh, that's nice. That's great. For like
one
the Hera guide we did earlier today,
staff.
Hell,
so
those types of gods.
The cost on the item.
That's great.
And then making a change to Sorcerer's Staff, the tier 2, we're going to be adding some magical power to it from 30 up to 45.
Ooh.
Yep, so you can see the theme here, a lot of underutilized mage items, just bringing them up so that they're a bit more competitive.
Ooh.
Increase the item pool that mages have to use. Warlock staff
was
underwhelming. We're decreasing the cost to make it easier to build into. And then the sorcerer staff, building just the tier 2 of it felt really bad compared to other starter routes that you could go.
For sure.
So making it stronger so it competes with other kind of choices that you can make.
Okay.
Right, let's move on and talk about some tank and guardian
Warlock
items.
Staff, huh?
One, I feel like I definitely haven't said this item in a long time. Bulwark of Hope. We're going to be increasing the percent HP threshold where the shield triggers from 30% up to 40%.
Yeah, so this should mean that Bulwark of Hope's trigger will happen a little bit more often. We looked at its stats and costs. We think it's generally in a pretty good spot. This change will help it bring it a little bit more prevalent, especially in a meta now where there's a lot more shield counters. So let's see how that one goes.
Okay, whatever.
All right, next up, we've got Heartward Amulet. We're going to be increasing the magical protection provided for by the aura from 15% to 20, not percent, I'm sorry.
Yeah, so before we kind of move on to this change, it's worth noting that the rest of these are kind of tankier items, either for actual pure guardians or bruiser kind of tanky warriors.
I mean, that's next to 20 about protected for your team.
Here, which is the sledge. I know a lot of people are building sledge a lot, probably
don't you dare
to be
nerf my
strong
sledge
and expect kind of a nerf for it, but we're not doing that right now. We think that warriors actually kind of rely on its core strength. So rather
don't
than adjust
dare
it right now, we want
you
to bring up other options.
You can't
so
nerf the sledge.
More opportunities for warriors to build different things, and then
it's
we
impossible
can look at sledge adjustments just to make sure that.
Yeah, you know what they tried. They tried to nerf
early
the sledge,
give them
dude
some more options.
They
and
tried,
sledge
and they got sledged
so
right back.
List, it just
every time they tried
to
type it into the game, sledge went wham,
so
deleted
more,
all the code.
Ally protection.
He can't nerf the sledge. The sledge can only be buffed.
All right, let's talk
okay
about some anti-heal now.
Can do
Pestilence,
it.
And I'll kind of lump these
back
two together. Pestilence and Contagion.
Best
we're
item
be
in the game.
Increasing the health on both the items by 50. Pestilence is 200 to 250. Contagion is 100 to 150.
Okay.
Yeah, we did a lot
more
of passes
health
on the anti-heal items previously for the offensive ones to make sure that it didn't really feel bad to pick up the items, right? So the Divine Ruin, Brawl of Beats, if you actually don't mind picking up, they're pretty decent. But Pestilence and Contagion never really quite felt that way. They're okay, but we think with the 50
like
health boost, you'll actually feel like you definitely kind of want to pick this up and feel favorable for
good
it.
Yeah. Buffing anti-heal is great. We love buffing anti-heal.
Fun one. We're going to be decreasing the cost from 2450 down to 2350.
Yeah, we did adjustments similar to this before, making it easier to build into. We're just taking that a step further after we saw that some people experimented with it, but overall fell out. It probably needs to be brought down a little bit more. So we'll see where that kind of fits into warrior builds.
A little bit cheaper on the mystical.
All right, let's move right along into gods.
Mystical getting cheaper is always spooky.
Order, but don't hold me to
because
we're going to start with
it hits that value point early game where the damage is a lot.
Will now additionally Let Artemis cleanse herself of slows, and she will become immune to slows for 0.6 seconds when the ability is activated.
Nice.
So Pun alluded to this earlier. There's definitely some spicy stuff in some of these god changes. Nice. We wanted to go through and take this time in between god patches to look at a couple of gods who we think could use a little bit of extra flavor, a little bit of extra love. Artemis has seen some great days. She's seen some, you know, poor days. But we wanted to, you know, help her with one of her weak points. She doesn't really have mobility or an escape option by giving Vengeful Assault.
It's almost like a little Mercury too.
We think she'll be able to get a little flare, out of trickier situations flavor. Without having to necessarily use her ultimate. So hopefully this goes over pretty well.
Yeah, this is definitely a spicy one. I'm looking forward to seeing how the community receives it. Next up, we've got Baba Yaga. We're going to be making a buff to her here.
Please just
Baba's
fix
brew. We're
going to
be decreasing the cooldown, and it's going to be 14 seconds at all ranks.
Yep, she's probably getting pretty close to the point where, like, she's in a really, really good spot. Some people really think she's already good. Some think she's really underwhelming still. Baba's Brew, just the 16-second cooldown at the earlier ranks, made it very prohibitive to brew potions. You couldn't really utilize the cool flavor of your kit. And it also hurt her early game and mid-game clear significantly for not having those on a lower cooldown. So just reducing the cooldown to 14 seconds at all ranks will help her out, kind of smooth out.
She would be so good if she just wasn't so buggy, man. Yeah, I mean, if they don't bug fix her, then it doesn't matter.
Increasing the physical power scaling by 10%.
It's too buggy.
Yeah, I mean, Chaka's a little bit of a jack of all trades, right? He's got a really good laning phase. I think everyone who's comfortable in solo lane will pick up Chaka and still do pretty well. But he kind of transitions to that late game and only has that team-wide, you know, ulti. The
Chaka can hit hard, man.
But other than that, he doesn't do as much. We want
you
to
ever build like
level,
a full damage Chaka game?
So those Thunderstrikes are not going to
hit him. It'll really flock
him. 10% scaling changes do a really good job for a lot of warriors.
You build like a transcendence on Chaka? Hello, key messy up.
We're going to make some changes to her base stats here, increasing her base HP and her HP scaling per level.
Yeah, Chang'e is a very squishy mage. She tries to rely on her evasion, but because she has to stay in melee range for so long, her evasion can only help her out so much.
375
to
410.
Give her some tankier stats, she can actually play that kind
plus
of like bruiser mage
level.
Role a bit more directly.
That's an extra 250 HP total
per level as someone like Hades or Zhongqi. Those are like the actual pure tank kind of mages.
That's pretty nice.
But a little bit of extra help there will make sure that she can stay in the middle of a fight. Should help bring her up. Maybe we'll see some play from Chang'e, where she's kind of been on the lower end of play for quite some
time. To be fair, Chang'e's been the worst of the healer.
All right. Speaking
for
of somebody that's been kind of on the lower end, hasn't really been seeing a whole lot of pickup, we've got Guan Yu.
Yep.
Going to be doing a buff to Tallow Assault, increasing the damage per tick.
Tallow Assault is the one we're
going to
buff, is it?
It's going up to 22.
That's an interesting try. That's the one ability I probably
wouldn't
have buffed.
Yeah, we wanted to be very careful with Guan Yu changes.
Yeah, you
got to
be very careful.
Strong. We did a lot of changes with passive. Tallow Assault on paper
my Guan Yu guy
damage,
just became even more viable because that's
really
a jungle change.
The long
that's
channel
a jungle
time
buff.
For its damage means it's also pretty easily interruptible. So by increasing the damage just a little bit, we think that the effectiveness you'll be getting out of it in lane will be a lot higher. So hopefully
that's a jungle buff. You're still going to get interrupted
definitely.
In lane,
right,
but in the jungle and the ganking, man,
and I'm pretty excited
it's
about
a big
it.
Fat jungle Guan buff.
Making a change to Shockwave here, and we're going to be increasing the fall-off damage from 50% to 70%
ooh, nice.
Of the base damage of the ability.
Good.
And it's kind
that'll
of
help with Gab's lane clear quite a bit. Hopefully.
Yeah, so in melee range Shockwave, it does full damage, and at max range, it does about 50%. We're bringing that 50% to 70%, so max range will be doing more. We've seen Geb be this kind of like pretty consistent support pick, but even in metas that we would expect him to do well, such as the crit meta, where his passive has like a lot of
he
potential
doesn't,
payoff.
Because he can't clear.
He wasn't really being picked and has been falling out of favor compared to other supports. And we feel like his overall toolkit is pretty strong.
It is.
But the early laning phase and the mid game kind of limit what he can do.
That's true.
So we're bringing that up to make
that's
sure that Geb has an opportunity to kind of roll in matches.
Good for him. Geb is so good, like after 20 minutes.
Next up, we've got Nemesis, who's seen a huge rise in popularity here over the past couple weeks.
Good change.
Making a nerf to Slice and Dice here, decreasing the damage from 50 to 170 down to 45 to 165.
That won't be enough. She'll still be banned every game.
Yeah, we played around with the Slice and Dice numbers quite a bit because, you know, Nemesis kind of dies by this ability quite severely. It's her primary jungle clear, a really heavy DPS in fights as well. So this is a half revert from the buff that we gave her before to make sure
she's
that
still
she still
bad
stays
every game.
Competitive. We think this plus the jungle changes we've done previously should help out. And the SPL on a competitive level, she's still used a lot, so we want to be careful of that. We also want to be careful because we know that she's a pretty valid and valuable counter to Cthulhu as well, which is one of the reasons why we're assuming her play count has increased the way it has. So we think this should be all right.
She's very, 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 very good.
All right, we're moving right along here. We've got Ra up next.
It's not going to stop from being very good.
Change to Celestial Beam, increasing the magical power scaling.
What?
And then Divine Light. Additionally, now this ability is going to cleanse Ra of slows, and he's going to be immune to slows for 0.6 seconds.
Kind of like no, don't do that. Yeah, no.
He's another character that doesn't really have a great way to be mobile. He also has to kind of get close and stay around like mid-ranger fights to make sure he can land Celestial Beams.
Oh, man, Ra just became such a good mid laner. It's crazy. That's the biggest buff of the day.
Just that extra tool to survive some situations he wouldn't otherwise survive.
Ra just became a top 3 mid laner instantly.
This is a relatively hard to confirm ability. It's very well telegraphed, has a travel time. And so this makes it more rewarding when you do land that skill shot.
Next up,
we got Zeus, and this is another fun one. For base stats here, we're going to be increasing Zeus's base attack speed.
He's already so fast.
Up to 0.95.
Who?
And Pawn, I'll let you kind of explain kind of what's going on with this one and how this will impact Zeus.
So the base attack speed is one of the most important stats for like any in-hander. It affects how any percent increase works. So 10% now will actually give you 0.095 instead of 0.087. And he also starts with just more attack speed. So he's actually going to be throwing out his lightning bolts more often.
It's very
He'll get extra synergy with his passive. He'll get extra synergy with the Aegis that he throws out. So just a nice quality life buff for Zeus will help him clear a little bit better in Conquest, especially early on, and get that little extra bit out of his passive.
Awesome. I hear aggro cheering and celebration from the group. All right. We've got two more changes here for God Balance.
All right.
There are actually a couple of reverts from past nerfs that we've done. First one is going to be for Odin and Gungnir's Might. We're going to be decreasing the cooldown from 14 seconds back down to 12 seconds.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, so when Odin got his ability change, he rose in popularity quite a bit. And then similarly to Isis, we just hit him with everything we got back to back on several different patches. We went through and basically I think all the cooldowns on his abilities have increased, and we chose one of them now to revert, because I think you guys have probably noticed in game, you don't see much Odin anymore after all the changes. So with this revert, we think we're gonna help bring him back to a safe spot.
That's fine. He's still a great counter pick.
All right, and then last up for God changes, we've got Hoon Bats. Making a change to Fear No Evil, the ultimate. We're going to be decreasing the cooldown. And that's going to scale up from 110 to 90 instead of being 120 seconds.
I don't love that. I don't want it. I don't want it.
People definitely recognize Hoon Bats' ultimate is definitely like one of the strongest portions of the game.
Such a good ability.
Really teamfight ultimate. But when we change it to 120 seconds at all ranks, we saw Hoon Bats go from being played pretty consistently to just falling off almost completely. We've seen a little bit of experimentation still, but not much success. And so we're going to revert this, especially with all the changes we've done to the jungle, what junglers are viable.
If you have 40% CDR, what's the math on that? 54 second cooldown, Hun Metzl?
And then we're going to look at potentially other places to nerf him if we do actually need to.
That's so low.
All right, that wraps it up for John.
Low.
We got through it, guys. There was a lot to go over.
He's too low.
Let's start talking about some skins. We've got an all-new battle pass that's coming out in the Odyssey Reckoning update that's coming out towards September. And this one is called Necropolis. And this is a new theme that we're kind of taking on. Necropolis is kind of an old, forgotten, forsaken land with its own sets of kingdoms and rules. But everything is a little bit more on the creepy side, as you guys will see as we start going through these skins. The first skin that we want to show off here is for Isis, and it's called Razor's Edge, and this one is definitely awesome.
You gotta give me a skin, but
she's
not
wearing
a buff.
Mask, staying safe.
That mask
this
is
one
cool.
Super dope.
That's cool.
What do you guys think?
I mean, that's just I love the staff.
Yeah, the staff is cool. Just looking at like the creepy skull like mask at the bottom with the jaws hollowed out, I think that immediately drew my eye.
I know, right? I love the green energy, and I'm definitely loving the treatment on the wings, how they're kind of like metal there. But I wonder how she sounds wearing that mask. So let's take a listen to the voice pack here.
Please make her sound like Bane.
Long have I wandered this plane.
I just wanted it to be Bane's voice, dude. Oh, goodness.
That's Razor's Edge Isis, and I believe this is going to be the first skin in the battle pass. So when you pick it up, this is the first skin that you'll be able to unlock. Yeah. And I'm definitely looking forward
to that. I'm fine with that.
I'm also looking forward to the next skin that we want to show off, because it is Infernal Omen Tsukiyomi. And it is Tsukiyomi's first skin. That's actually a real quick turnaround on that. What do you guys think about this one?
I mean, I love the two weapons that we have for him, where they are kind of opposing, because the art team gets to just do so much cool stuff with it.
Yeah.
I know, right?
The, like, it's so awesome.
So cool.
Yeah, let's go ahead and take a look at the model here. I want to see how those weapons look. Nice. Love the treatment. I definitely love the taste of having one weapon a lighter color.
Honestly?
And then
they like the original Suki skin better. I really like original Suki skin.
Right? Let's go ahead and take
I think
a
his regular skin is really good.
My blades thirst for your blood.
And he wasn't edgy enough.
I know, right? So this is Tsukiyomi's first skin. So we actually want to take a little bit of time and show him off to you in game. So I believe Pawn is our driver for today, and production is going to get us right into game so we can kind of show off some of the abilities that and all how right. things are going to look once you unlock the skin in the battle pass. So Pawn, take us through and let's look at what he's got going on here. Basics look so clean. Love the dark. The red and black is classic.
Nice. And the color scheme is just really good on it.
I love how like it's got like the dark trails. You got the bright red, but still like the dark trails of black. Oh, those caltrops are definitely creepy.
Yeah.
I do not want to.
Yeah, I mean, it's fine.
Oh, nice. Got some dark light here.
Fine.
Lots of really cool effects.
I know, wait. Tons of cool effects. Our team definitely killed it on that one. That's the second skin in the battle pass.
I don't think it's bad, but I don't think it's great.
Cover, so we got to get through it. The next skin from the battle pass that we want to show off is actually our battle pass recolor for this one, and it's actually going to be Sinister Sentinel Athena, and this one is a recolor of past Athena skin. I believe it's called Blight Guardian is what came out here. And I love
it's my favorite card art. Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Kind of darker. This one's got more of a brownish reddish tone here. What do you think of this one, Clumsy?
That's cool. I mean, it's cool. I like seeing these recolors in the sense that you don't almost realize that it's a recolor, right? Like, I saw this and I didn't actually assume that already because it's a completely different palette that we went with.
Yeah, I don't recognize
it.
My card art.
I just didn't recognize it.
I know, this one's super awesome. I believe we've got a turnaround ready, so we'll be able to see a little bit more how it looks in game. Yeah, the
I don't recognize the skin at all. This is sick. This is cool.
Definitely.
I don't recognize this honestly as a recolor.
This one is a recolor, so no new voice pack here. But you guys will be able to get this one. It is on the free
track
of the
that's a cool skin.
So as long as you're playing, getting those
that's a freaking baller recolor.
Unlock the skin as you progress through the track. Cool. And we've got one more Battle Pass skin that we want to show off to you guys.
All right.
Infernal Father Odin. And this one, he is the king of Necropolis. He is kind of the high-ranking Inquisitor.
Oh, is this
love the
Daddy?
Here.
Is this Daddy Odin? Look at that goatee.
I mean, like, this is, like, the final boss of, like, the, like, Holy Order, like, evil group that, like, uses light for bad. Look at that hammer in the background. Is he actually going to be just swinging a hammer?
Oh my goodness. Yeah, I definitely
it's a hammer.
Dude, and those shoulder pads are so spiky.
That is a large
this one so
hammer.
Cool.
That's a spicy meatball.
I know, right?
That's a thick boy,
a
dude. The sledge. It's the sledge.
Your jury. Your executioner.
I told you the sledge would find its way, dude.
Yep, that sounds about
it
right.
It would find its way.
Well, that wraps it up for the Necropolis.
You can't stop the sledge. It's everywhere.
For this new theme to get it in you guys' hands when the Odyssey Reckoning update goes live. But we just reviewed our next battle pass. That means that the one that's live in game is going away soon. You've got the Avatar The Last Airbender battle pass. That's
now.
Like I said earlier, if you guys still haven't had a chance to check it out to see the awesome content that's going on, we've got a really cool video to show to you guys. We'll be right back after the break to go over the Odyssey.
This world is in trouble.
We can't let this happen.
All right.
They need our help.
All right. Avatar Battle Pass. Smile. Yeah. All right. Laggy Avatar video. All right. All right. Secret tunnel! Secret tunnel! To the smite chair! Secret, 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 secret tunnel!
Yeah!
They're really committing to this chair. I mean, I respect me a nice chair. That chair would be able to handle all 8'6" of me, dude.
Welcome back, everybody.
Gotta get the special edition.
To get into the Odyssey Reckoning, our final big event for the end of the year here. And this event is going to be absolutely huge. We've got a lot to talk about here. So I had to bring out the big guns for this section here. Going over the Odyssey with me today, I've got AJ and I've got Tina here on the show. How you guys doing?
Hey, Isaiah. Glad to be here.
Yeah, it's been a long time.
I know. It's been like forever since I've even like seen you in person or talked to you, Tina. It's an absolute pleasure to have you.
I was enjoying my break, but I'm happy to come back and chit-chat about some cool Smite stuff.
Oh, the Odyssey is going to be super dope. But before we get into the Odyssey, Tina, the Odyssey is all about like voyaging and exploration, but every Voyager must have their log, right? So we've got another event that's coming out alongside the Odyssey called Voyager's Log. Tina, what's going to be happening with this Voyager's Log event?
So the Voyager's Log event is very similar to our previous birthday calendar event. And what it is basically you come into the event, and every day that you come in and you play a game, play one game, you will receive the reward for that day. So, and then it lasts 15 days. So if you come in every day for 15 days, you'll get all the rewards. Also, if you claim 6 days in any order, so just 6 days in total, you can receive the Voyager player title, which is also pretty cool.
Oh, nice. Definitely this works awesome. A lot like our community event from last year, or earlier this year. So this is a format everyone should expect, and it's everything is totally free. Just stop by and play some games when the patch drops, and you'll get some cool free stuff.
For sure. TLDR, log in, play a game, get free stuff for 15 days. It's super simple. Lots of awesome stuff that's going along alongside the Odyssey Reckoning, which is our grandiose, really big, super special event. And I know, Tina, you've been doing a lot of work getting this event ready. So I'll kind of let Odyssey you take it off and give you just a brief little overview of what's going on with the Odyssey. Just like a kind of one-liner, just to kind of before we dive deep into it.
Okay, so for this year's Odyssey, we've kind of like come up with some new design changes to it. So we've added like a grand map to the Odyssey where you can explore like new cultures and unexplored lands, and while also battling the corruption that is Cthulhu, who's still like dominant over this world. And you basically do quests and get rewards for doing the quests on these new voyages that you get to go on. if we have a picture, you can see it better.
Yeah, we wanted to bring back some of the Odyssey's roots. The event is, you know, specifically a way for players to get a bunch of cool god skins for a bunch of their favorite gods, and we wanted to keep a lot of the format the same. The things that our players really look forward to, but we wanted to have more theming to it, more gameplay to it. So Tina spent a lot of time working with the UI team and the design team to come up with this really interesting whole map to explore. And this is so much deeper than a lot of the maps kind of presentations we've done in the old Odysseys, where you would just kind of see a bunch of the items or things just spread out on a map. This one is actually very interactive. Players will get to choose which different types of regions. All of the regions are themed around our existing pantheons. They have all sorts of cool tie-ins to lore and gods in the game. And you'll get to choose how you want to explore those for your quests. And you'll also be able to choose which rewards you want to go after, of course, because that's a that would be a big influencer on which regions you choose to explore and which quests you want to do. Is you can preview which rewards you'll learn and you can pick accordingly.
Yeah, for sure. I think the big thing is we had a lot of feedback how the Odyssey didn't feel as immersive, and it just felt like another buy through event. So we really, took some extra time to make it really engaging, lots of stuff for you guys to do, quests to complete, and also lots of new ways to earn Odyssey points and progress through the event rather than just buying content. So yeah, let's go ahead and start talking about the gameplay. And AJ, you kind of hinted towards the map. What's going on with the map and how does it work?
Show me this map,
all right,
AJ.
There's a big Odyssey map with this event. Each map has its own territory, which has a whole bunch of different rewards. You'll be able to preview those and choose which rewards you want to go after before you start any of your quests. Everyone will start with the first territory, Niflheim, based off of the Norse
nice.
Frost
we all saw
world.
Niflheim.
That
all
territory
right.
will be unlocked for everybody, and they can play through the quests to earn the free rewards. However, to unlock the other regions, you'll have to earn map fragments by purchasing Odyssey points. Skins. Yeah.
It's a nice
which
printer.
You essentially can get through
it
earning
is.
Odyssey points,
seriously.
Right? The biggest cool thing about this whole update is that you can earn Odyssey points from more things than just buying Odyssey skins. Pretty much participating in any of Smite's skins anywhere in the updates for the next few months will earn you Odyssey points that you can earn towards your Odyssey progress, which we know that players really like to kind of pick and choose their Odyssey items, and now you have even more power to do that. You can earn the tier 5 by getting less of the actual Odyssey items if you don't want to, and doing other things. Like if you're always buying the battle passes, you're going to be getting Odyssey points from that.
Yes. Right, and if you want a detailed list, you can find that on the update show notes as well.
Yep.
We Patch also took the quests further.
Yeah.
So with each quest and each region has different directions you can go and paths you can take, and they're going to have different difficulty quests and even areas that we call the corrupted areas that have even more difficult quests, but then better rewards. So there's a lot of room to explore, and it gives you a cool like view of the Smite universe in a sort of like focused sense, where instead of exploring the whole world, we have this cool like fictional continent we created that has bits of every pantheon represented on it.
It's very based on like choice. Like you as the player making your own choice to go on a voyage that of your choosing. So we really wanted to play that up.
Yeah, play it up. Play it up,
sure.
Tina.
The Odyssey will kind of work how it is.
Are we not gonna get to see it? I really thought we were gonna get to see the map after all this. I don't think we're gonna see it.
You can do to kind of pre-order all the content.
I really thought this was like show us the map. I don't think they have the map ready.
Also, the individual skins that will be released. And they'll be discounted for a couple weeks after they come out online. So definitely be sure. The buy all option is 8,000 gems, and you'll get access to all of the Odyssey content.
AK gems, baby!
And all of the reward content that's available for that patch, as well as
AK gem
pre-order. To our Tier 5 Hell skin, which we're going to get to in a little bit. But we've got some other awesome Odyssey skins that we want to talk about. So let's go ahead and kick things off here. Let's start with Winged Death Thanatos. And this one is super cool. Another winged death skin. Kind of, he's like a raven, right, Tina?
Yes, he is. He's like really bright and red and just very edgy. He could like honestly be brothers with the Tsukiyomi skin that we just saw.
Oh, that's true. I didn't even make that correlation.
Yeah, they're like edgy brothers.
Thanatos is obviously a fantastic god for badass skins. This is the kind of whole category we use to loosely define a lot of these skins that are a little more intimidating. I think this one is a more in line with our kind of living armor idea, which we've used before
Thanatos
on
is always
gods like
so
Pele
cool.
and Hercules, but we took it in a
it's
different
impossible
color direction
to choose
to feel
what
more
Thanatos skin to use, because every skin turns out cool on him.
Mentions back to blood magic.
Every single skin.
Let's go ahead and take a listen to
there's
the
just no helping it
to get a little bit more idea what's going on.
No prayer can save you from death's embrace.
Yeah, that's
that
totally
is definitely the edge that we're looking for Thanatos skins. I'm definitely looking forward to that one. Next up, we've got a skin for Zeus here. I can hear aggro cheering again. But high voltage Zeus. This one is super cool. I had an opportunity to look at the card art earlier today. And this one's kind of futuristic here. He's got kind of some armor that's going on.
Weird. Different.
This one's more along lines, I think, of the more modern hero type of reinterpretation of the gods, which we've done recently with like Toxic Emoja. which is a cool take on a villainess with not crazy sci-fi distant tech, but something that's almost believable, but as if this were a superhero or supervillain in the world right now. And of course, Zeus wielding his power of electricity, it was designed as if with those electricity themes in mind, as opposed to Umoja's.
It's almost like Zeus X-Men edition. You know,
be able to see some more of this armor and stuff that's going on in game, and oh, that cloud stuff on the bottom—that's super dope. I'm loving the shield texture.
This is like sexy Zeus. This is hot Zeus.
Feels clean and sleek, but still badass.
I like it. Let's go ahead and take a listen to the voice back for High Voltage Zeus.
This much power—it's amazing.
Look at that! Look at that hair, dude.
He's definitely
look at those scars. Oh man!
You can see it flowing in his like
exoskeletal
armor there, and it's kind of pulsating in his shield. Definitely super awesome, and looking forward to that one.
It's getting hot here, dude.
The community has been looking forward to up next. We got Mysterious Warrior Mulan, and this one was top in the community once Mulan was released. They wanted that disguised version, so we came out and said that we're going to be making one, and it is finally
the original.
This is what
Mulan was originally going to look like,
accumulating Odyssey points. Tina and Ava,
and then they decided to not do it.
So this one
is
the modified scarf over the face and the completely different breastplate changes
that should have been the original.
Revealed her true identity. A lot of players resonated
been the original
very strongly
Mulan.
With this depiction of Mulan.
It should have been.
Looked for a place so someone can access this as a free reward, right? We wanted to make sure this skin would be pretty easily accessible to the community. So this one is the first skin reward on
the whole freaking point
Odyssey,
of the story.
Which, you know, probably worth mentioning again. With every Odyssey skin you buy,
I'm
you're
not salty
get,
about it.
Map fragments to open up more quests and more rewards there. You're going to get Odyssey points, which unlock you towards the next rewards, which lead you towards an Odyssey chest. With every update where you can get all sorts of amazing skins from all of Smite history, as well as earning you towards the bigger reward tiers, like this is the first one where you'll unlock this skin and the Odyssey chest at the same time. So every time you participate in the Odyssey, your rewards just stack up and stack up. This is just the first one along the road to the Hell Tier 5. And I can't wait to show you the other rewards we've got. I love Mulan, but the next one I think is really impressive.
It's the best. All right. Yes.
And, I'm getting a little dizzy. Getting a little dizzy. A little bit less spinning. A little bit less spinning. We're spinning too much. One spin, two spin tops.
I'm here to win wars and save my country. And there's nothing about me that's not masculine.
Nice. So this is Mysterious Warrior Mulan coming at you. It's the first reward skin in the Odyssey. But we got another reward skin that we want to talk about. And I know Tina is super excited about this one.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody is.
Gladiator Xing Tian. And this one is just like, it's so outside the box on what we normally do.
I love it already.
So I'll let Tina kind of take it away and talk about these little gecko guys.
I love it.
Well, this one, so he is like,
embrace
it's like a bunch of little gecko friends who are basically controlling this like big gecko
gladiator
body. So
and
you can see them like poke out of like the different holes like in his shoulders and in his head and on his side. It's super cute and it looks great.
Take a look at it.
Three geckos in a trench coat, folks. Nothing to see here.
So impressive.
They only want one
really
movie
good.
Ticket.
Oh,
I love
it.
I love troll skins. I think troll skins are the best.
And we tried with like covering him more with like colors.
I'm a big fan of troll skins.
It was just feeling kind of strange. So instead, we came up with this idea of this fantasy of these like gecko tribe that lives in the jungle, but they have this like construct that they jump in like a, you know, like superheroes in control to defend their lands against invaders.
Exactly. And I know
look
one
at
thing,
how cute they are.
This little guardian thing is probably well insured here. Let's go ahead.
You could have saved 400 gems by switching to Geico, folks.
You think you can mess with us? A misstep for you.
Oh, yeah, that is unbearable.
It's
perfect. It's perfect.
This one is super cool. Reward skin in the Odyssey that is coming out in the next update here. We've got another skin that we want to take a look at before we get into hell. Just one more, guys. Excalibur King Arthur is going to be coming your way, and he is actually going to be a part of this year's Odyssey chest. And this one is a kind of a different take on King Arthur. He's like a mecha knight that's been kind of formed by a futuristic kind of company called Avalon Industries.
I thought that Cursed was a different take on the King Arthur story.
But yeah, sometimes Mac we like to play with scale on the card art. I assure you he is
even crazier.
But yeah, this skin was just a really cool merger.
A very different take.
Some mech themes, wow, as well as some King Arthur themes. I think it does a really good job of differentiating itself from other mechs. It feels really unique. It feels really specific and fits King Arthur just really well. I'm really happy with how it turned out. It looks awesome.
It does.
I'm loving it. Look at the added textures there. You got some nice wings.
Gotta be honest, I don't get any Arthur vibes. I get zero Arthur vibes.
Let's go ahead and take a listen to the voice back for Excalibur King Arthur.
It doesn't look like Arthur at all.
In the nano printers of Avalon Industries, I wield 3 Excalibur.
Nice. For Camelot, for Avalon, definitely looking forward to getting this one as a part of the Odyssey chest. In the next
I don't love when you can't tell what god a skin is for.
It's time for tier 5.
I don't love that.
Eclipse Summoner of Hell.
I think that's confusing for new players.
As we get the card art and in-game turnarounds ready, there's a lot to go over. This one's super in-depth here. AJ, talk to me kind of about how we landed on Eclipse Summoner of Hell and kind of where we drew inspiration for this new tier 5.
Tier 5s are always a challenge, right? There's so much to consider from theme to tech quality to art quality, and we want just players to be blown away by every one of them, so we always try to push ourselves to come up with something new. Hel is a duality goddess, right? She is about light and dark. She has two forms, but she also has opposing themes, right? Good and evil, light and darkness. This skin came from a combination of fantasy elements, cosmic elements, and even some more interesting, like philosophical or almost divine or a geometrical type of patterns. So what we have here is Hel taking the form of a oracle of sorts, someone heavily in tuned with the cosmos and the sun and the moon, and she exercises her powers through the use of her summoned guardians. This is something you might see in a lot of different, you know, popular fiction, anime, etc., is that these Hels actually fight alongside their guardians at all times. Mm-hmm. Which, honestly, this skin turnaround right here is a little misleading, because this is never how the skin actually looks in the game. Sun and the moon guardian are always paired alongside Hel, fighting with her and being the conduit for her powers.
Okay.
The lighter form, which is more slender, designed like a mage, meant to be healing and regenerative, restorative, and the moon form, which is more intimidating and violent and uses Hel's dark stance ability to debuff and damage her opponents.
For sure. Well, let's go ahead and take a look at it in game. Pawn is our driver, and I believe we are.
I think I need to see this to understand. I don't understand. I don't know. I don't get the anime reference.
It's so cool.
Oh.
So what you're gonna get with this skin is you're gonna have the Hel skin, where Hel is like the light form Hel and dark form Hel, paired with the light form guardian and the dark form guardian. So that's really like 4 models up front, or 3 or so, because, you know, the Hel has to share some similarities. Right. And then all of those upgrade upon leveling up, you're going to see as we go through the demo showing the abilities and stuff, that once Hel reaches a certain level, her armor, as well as the guardians, summoned guardians, body parts and armor are all going to get more extravagant and more powered up when the game progresses.
Okay.
Yes, I believe it's at level 10, but let's go ahead and start going through some abilities, and we'll start off with the light side here. And as we go through it, Tina, you want to talk to me about kind of the personalities that come with each of the kind of the guardians and Hel herself, because I know you did a lot of work on the voice back.
Light Hel, she's more of like a little bit reserved, but yet also like full of wisdom, and she also is commanding, like, but in a lighter way, not in a harsh way. And her guardian is more like just obeys her, but also tries to help her and has feelings for her, like, because she is not only her master but also like a friend. And in the dark stance, she is more commanding in a sense that she is like more rough and rugged.
That's a cool one. That's a really cool one in Dark Stance, man.
The Guardian is more of a like protector, but also in a mean sense of a way. Like,
that's a freaking cool one.
How do you say it? Like, doesn't let anyone touch her.
Yeah, he's a bodyguard. Also, like,
yeah, right, he's like, yeah, very rough about it. And he's not like kind or nice or sweet.
And as you can see upon playing through the abilities, it was really important to the skin from an animation and effects to represent those personalities that Tina was just talking about. So you can see the characters, the guardians, are a huge part of her combat. We want them to feel like they're fighting together. Every ability includes a lot of actions from both Hell and her guardian. When you heal an ally,
it might be a little bit confusing fighting this
for a second. When you
throw
the dark stance,
some of your abilities that when you throw at Hell look like they can hit the guardian, but like not Hell. I think it's gonna feel a little weird fighting.
Play up the action of this duality character that's not only has two differing forms, but also represents duality by showing two characters fighting together, like in perfect harmony.
Yeah, they work together very well, and they talk
beefy
to each
boy.
Other too. They
so there's the upgrade where you can see the Moon Guardian.
That's
added
a beefy boy level up.
A lot of additional emissives and those extra moon symbols to his armor, as well as Hell's headdress and these glowing glyphs that float off of them. And the Sun Stance has just as many upgrades. Like,
loving the idol variants and all the like small interactions between Hell and her guardian.
Definitely, yeah, she has a bunch of new idols to play.
It's cool. It's very
when you're in the game
different.
You can see her interacting with her guardians in different ways.
It's very different.
Of course, the light one is a little bit more fun, and the moon dark one is a little bit more intimidating.
I'm not sure that it's my favorite, AJ, but I do like that it's different.
Challenges,
so I like the taking a shot, you know.
Character kind of in the game space at the same time. I know it took a ton of work, right?
Yes, especially for the animation.
I like
team,
it better than like
technical art team and even the gameplay
four, definitely.
And
like the
Hui
one, I hate the Hui one.
Simultaneously work together is really difficult and brings a lot of challenges. You have to make sure your
animations never get desynced. But I don't think it's good as like the Cuckoo one or the Thanatos
sure
one. That's kind of where I'm leaning right now.
Just one
kind of towards the middle.
That has a whole bunch of different complications
that's where I'm leading.
So it's about finding the sweet spot in between all those things, as well as getting them to spawn in and animate and do all these different things as part of all the abilities. This is a really big.
I like the dark stance a lot.
In a lot of ways, a lot of things can go wrong.
I think the abilities look
like
really
that.
Cool.
And it's something that we just really tried to turn up to 11 on this skin, more so than anything you've ever really seen in Smite, with this detail of characters being part of the abilities and for fighting two characters side by side together.
Most definitely, as Pong's showing off new taunts and waves and claps, and you've got separate animation for the sun and the moon, and we've got a VXG to show off here too. Oh, I love that taunt where he's kind of showing the short and saying, "Hey, don't mess with my my summoner here." Yes, my lady. This one turned out super awesome. And here we
That's
go.
Pretty
we
cool.
Got the VXG hug and walk around, and she's got both of them, and it's super symbolic of the eclipse, right? The rotations and the orbit on them.
So you can show off both your guardians.
I like it.
If you really want to swag out.
This is kind of super awesome. I believe let's go ahead and turn through and listen to some of the voice back lines before we're talking about it. If you want to do some DPS before we close it out here.
The light of the sun guides me. Darkness should not be your path, as it will be your end. Come back to the light before it is too late. Law has spoken. Do what must be done.
As you command.
Get rid of them. I don't care what you do.
It will be
it's fine.
Done.
I like it though.
Power so much prevails.
It's really about kind of creating this system where
I think it's good. I think it's
Priestess
good.
Priestess is fighting with her guardians, right? A lot of her power comes through them. So if you notice the animation team, they did a specific amount.
I think
where
it's fun. I think
her
it's different.
Basic attacks come from Hell.
I'm content with that as the tier 5.
The guardians, and this is
I'm
a
not,
time
I'm
where,
not
you know,
disappointed
as
with it.
Isaiah, my anime fan, I know you're familiar with this concept of characters fighting alongside these very interesting guardians or summoned or spirits, and we wanted to really play that up as much as we could.
For sure. I definitely saw a lot of specific anime references floating around after we teased this card on social media. But we're super excited about Eclipse Summoner Hell. We're super excited for you guys to get a chance for at our newest Tier 5. I believe PTS is targeted for Friday. So be sure to keep an eye out on Smite Games social media channels.
I don't think PTS matters.
Thanks
that
so much, everybody, for watching the show. Thanks so much. Stay safe.
Well, I mean, there was a lot of cool skins. The balance changes were pretty much all good. The bonus balance was great, and the bonus balance will go live in just 6 days on Tuesday, and then the actual patch won't come out for like 3 weeks or so, just under. I think it's 20 days is when the actual patch will come out. But overall, changes to items were mostly good. Changes to gods were mostly good. The only thing that I'm super concerned about off the top of my head was the raw change. The raw change, I think, might make raw a little unbearable, specifically because he's already so fast, and then giving him the slow immunity on the two is gonna make him like really, really hard to hit. On top of the Doom Orb change, which is a great item for rocks, so it makes him faster, being cheaper, so he can get that quicker. All really good things there for